JazakAllah, President, and also Jihad and Jackson,
Jaibur,
and
okay. Alhamdulillah. Now, I have to begin now for fermentation principles. Very important, you must be able to evaluate from the outset whether the fermentation will be successful or not. From the outset, I will give you five criteria that from my reading will have to be present in order for the microbes to grow. One, this is five must criteria. One, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay? I will start with number one. Viable inoculum. This is the first step from your petri dish or from your MQ or from your stock culture. You must be able to produce viable inoculum. Not just inoculum, but viable. Meaning to say, it has enough volume. If you want to inoculate a 10 liter fermenter, you only have 1 mL, which is not good. You must have at least 10 to 20% of the culture volume. So if the culture volume is 10 liter, then you must have at least 1 liter or 15 liters to 20 liters of inoculum. And this you must prepare. And you must prepare them fresh. It is what means by the volume of inoculum in relation to the culture volume. It should be about 10 to 20% of culture volume. Okay? If you don't have this, you will have not much of a big problem. You will have very low productivity. Why? Because in the batch fermentation, if you will have very little inoculum in terms of volume or not enough, you will have very long lag phase. Yeah? Very long lag, because it requires time for microbe to double itself. 2 becomes 4, 4 becomes 8, 8 becomes 16, 16 becomes 32. And imagine if you just have 1 liter, that's supposed to be 10 liter, inoculated in a 100 liter fermenter, then you will have a big problem. It will grow, but it will grow so long, and therefore you will have your productivity very much now. Why? Because the time increases so much. Remember, productivity is the measure of the effectiveness of the fermentation system that you are working on. And it is measured in terms of productivity is like that. So, if your time is long, then you have a big problem, because it is in the denominator. Yeah? So, first must criteria, you must have bioengineering in terms of volume. Second, you must also look into the concentration of the spores if you use spores. Usually it will be 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7 spores per week. If you have less than that, you also have long dead phase. And that will bring down your productivity because you need more time to achieve the effectiveness of the system to produce the product. Okay, you with me, Jackson? Okay, it's very logical here. Yeah. So you must have the first step to make sure you have enough inoculum in terms of volume and in terms of the concentration of the spore. And if you start with vegetative cells, then you must start with the vegetative cells at the exponential stage. That therefore it is a unit operation by itself. Okay? Now, third one, you must make sure the viability in terms of morphology mobility, at least those two. How are you going to do this? Morphology and mobility? Anybody know? You are a microbiologist, you need to see the morphology of the microbes, you need to see the mobility. What instrument you use? Not the camera?
Microscope.
Microscope. You need a microscope to look into it and see the morphology and the viability. Morphology, you can plate on a PDA, potato dextrose agar, and you can see. That's why if you see any bulletins about microbiology, you will see a nice, beautiful lady looking at petri dish, and she's doing that because she wants to see the morphology. If it's specialist, you can see the striations at the end of the growth pattern. If it's penicillin, we can see other growth patterns. So it's very important, this brief. Once you're okay with this, then you look into the second must criteria. I want to ensure you remember this because if you don't have any one of that, the growth will be severely reduced. So you go one step at a time. Now, what's the second one? You can guess? It's like getting something to grow. Now you have an inoculum, a viable inoculum, it's enough in terms of volume, it's enough in terms of concentration, it's enough in terms of mobility, it's enough in terms of morphology. What next? Sorry?
Substrate.
Substrates are important, and we will look, put that as number three, which is the micro and macronutrients, which you may put as equivalent to substrate. Yeah, and it can be in terms of lignocellulosic material, it can be in terms of many other organic materials, it can be in terms of just glucose or maltose or all those monosaccharides. Yeah, now most important number two I want to put is adequate energy. For most microbes, they are chemotrophs, so they will develop their energy, they will produce their energy requirement through the assimilation of the glucose and develop ATP, and therefore they get energy. But if it's algae, it's green in color, they would require energy from the sunlight or from illumination. So you have to think about first, the viability of the inoculum. Second, the energy requirement. Third, the nutrient requirement. Very systematic. Then number four, absence of inhibitors. If you have a microbe, say bacillus, but you did not do enough sterilization of the medium you use, enough sterilization of the fermenter that you use, you did not sterilize the air that goes into the sterile zone, then you have contamination by microbes from outside. Then it will be inhibiting your growth, yeah, because of competitive requirements of the medium. There is another inhibitor present in the batch culture. It will be the metabolite produced by the fermentation. The excretions from the microbial cells will also be considered inhibitors to the growth. There is another one, which is the really mutagenesis. Mutants that somehow during the process will revert to the original station that they are. That is why for me, I always prefer to use native microbes other than mutant in my work, especially if the fermentation time is long. Yeah? If the fermentation time is long for you to harvest, then I will prefer to use natural reoccurring microbes rather than recombinant microbe or some microbe that can be detected by exposure to UV or some exposure to mutagens. Right, last one, number five, will be stable physical chemical conditions. For example, this is the fermentation zone. The temperature seems to be unstable. 35, 40, then goes down to 30, then the microbe doesn't like it. We don't like it as well. So the temperature must be stable. So you must have a system to ensure temperature stability. Yeah. Number two, once you've got the temperature total out, you want to get the revolution per minute, which is the measure of agitation. Yeah. If you use a continuous step fan reactor, you will have like that. There is an impeller. There's a level of culture, then you stir it. It is usually called CSTR, which is continuous step tank reactor. Be careful here, because when you use CSTR, there are a lot of shear that is caused by the impeller hitting on the water interface. Now, if you use fungus, filamentous organisms, or even yeast, they will not like it, because the fungus grows at the tip of the hyphae, and if it gets to be disturbed or in collision with the tip of the impeller, then it will not grow very well. Similarly with yeast grow in a budding situation. It grows a bud, like a potato bud. Then this bud will be cut off or will be sheared by the impeller, and the yeast will not like it. Yeah? So usually when you use CSTR, which is a continuous step time reactor, at a certain revolution per minute, you are basically using bacteria. because bacteria has got very tough, robust cell wall, and it is able to withstand such shear by the impeller. But if you still want to use CFTR, and you have to use fungus, filamentous fungus, like Penicillium praecium, or like Aspergillus, or like Trichoderma. These are names of elements organic used in industry. And you still have to use this. What sort of innovation or adjustment to the system would you do? Suggest. Remember, you don't like the shear. Sorry? What would you do to change the system configuration to allow the use of CFTR when you need to use filamentous organisms? What do you do to modify your fermentation system? Taking note of the requirement of the filamentous fungus. You change the impeller. Correct. From which impeller to which impeller? But you change the impeller, yeah? Because my hope is you are able to innovate the system, the fermentation system. There are many types of impeller. You have the turbine impeller, you have the pedal impeller, and you can control your RPM by the motor. There is a motor up there, and you will control it in such a way that you don't disturb the growth pattern of the microbes that you use in the fermentation. Yeah? Because you still need to use this. Meaning to say, you still need to use submerged fermentation. Now, when you study fermentation based on these five must criteria, you can innovate. You can be very sure that you are giving attention to five most important criteria. And if you take note of all this, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and you take note of the domain of productivity, to increase productivity, you must reduce the time of harvesting. You must reduce the volume, the cultural volume. Then you will increase the productivity. Therefore, you increase the efficiency of the fermentation system to produce the product. Okay? As I have mentioned in the first lecture, you have to pay attention to another objectively verifiable parameters, which is Jackson Rouleau. I mentioned two very important aspects of measurement of fermentation system. One is productivity, the other is no? No. You should know. You should know. It's in your notes. Have a guess. Sorry? No? No? You remember now?
Yeah.
It measures the efficiency of the microbial cell to utilize the substrate in the metabolism to direct it to produce product or to produce the biomass or to produce the enzyme or to produce the maintenance energy for the microbes to grow or to produce the transport energy or maybe any other things which you don't know. And this must be equal or less than 1.0, the total sum. And this I have mentioned to BC, economy, cellular economy. Yeah? Immediately giving you the ability to evaluate and to weigh whether what you have done to the fermentation system based on these five focus gives you positive results or not. And you will also know the limit of yield. Because the summation of all that must be equal to less than or equal to 1. Because in the definition of yield, it is a nisba, it is a ratio. Yeah? So, theoretically, YXS can be equal to 0.5 to 0.6. That means, for every 10 units of substrate utilized, yeah, 5 units of that goes to producing your biomass. Then, what about the production of products like ethacrylic acid or citric acid or delta endotoxin in the bacillus, this type of product, or antibiotics? This is about 0.3 to 0.4 in terms of value. Then, if you say the maximum here is 0.6, here is 0.4, it's already 1. Therefore, it is impossible to have these numbers representing effectiveness of cells produced by biomass, representing effectiveness of cells produced the product. Yeah? It's impossible. So, because you need to have some here. Here could be 0.03, 0.02, 0.01, and several others. And you have to add up. So, your job as fermentation technologist is to look at the objectives of your fermentation. If you want to produce biomass, like you want to produce blue-green algae as biomass, you want to produce spirulina, you want to produce chlorella, you want to produce Bacillus thuringiensis. In fact, in all fermentation processes, you want to produce the biomass first. So you want to increase this to 0.65 or 0.7. By what technique? By looking at this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you are not fermentation technologist and you are into molecular biology, you will go into the cell of the microbe and start changing the genomic sequence and produce a recombinant microbe, and you will claim that you can go up to 0.70 by using the recombinant microbe. Now, you've got to ask them to complete the story. What about this value, and this value, and this value? You can check the journal to establish whether the full story has been told. Usually, they will look into just this and this. Sometimes just this only, and not this. Yeah? So, Here I am telling you that it is very important to look at both of the parameters to evaluate effectiveness of fermentation processes. One, productivity, to look into the effectiveness of the system. Another, the yield, to look at the effectiveness of the cellular metabolism. Okay? All right. Okay, this is the typical S curve for a batch fermentation. And batch fermentation is the most popular mode of reactor operation in industry because it is easy to operate. And it is on a batch process, batch-wise technique. And if you have a problem with that batch, you get a batch number. So the product can be recalled based on the batch number. Yeah? So I will pay more attention to batch process technique and a few pointers to take note of batch processes is that you usually will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 growth phases. This is for the batch. And in all fermentation work, I would ask all my students to produce this typical growth curve. Why? Because it will tell you a lot of story. Lots and lots of story for you to go forward in the understanding of the dynamics and kinetics of fermentation. Yeah? For example, phase number one. If it's a very long phase, then you know it's a problem. Yeah? So all your job is to reduce this phase. If phase just before the exponential phase, number three, is also very long to take it's to go on the expansion curve, then you know that is also a big problem. Something is not right with any one of these. Something is not right with one of the five. Now, the phase three. Can be represented mathematically using a straight line equation. This can be proven mathematically. And this is called exponential growth equation because it tells you what would be the concentration of microbes, X, at any specific time? Yeah? Making the assumption that you know mu. Yeah? Mu is a specific growth rate which we can measure. Yeah? So, if you know mu, you have one equation. You know, you have one unknown, then you can measure, you can calculate. Okay? So that's the importance of this. And here you can also measure yield to be the amount of microbes that you obtain at the harvesting time divided by the amount of substrate that is utilized. That gives you the yield. Remember, this is in weight form, yeah? Milligram per milligram. And this has to be about 0.7 and below. If you give me a data that is 0.8 for this value, then I will ask you to repeat the question. repeat the experiment, because it is not according to the theoretical understanding. And you need to repeat. If you repeat and you get the same, then we need to understand what actually happened. And your discussion point would be based on these five things. What have you done to the inoculum? What have you done to the energy supply? What have you done to the micro and macronutrients? What have you done to the taking away of inhibitors in the system? And what have you done to ensure that the temperature is steady, the RPM is steady, and you are not introducing systems problem to the growth of the microbe? So this will give you a good good pointers to carry out a discussion. Yeah? So you know why? You can also calculate mu using monod kinetics. This will give you the position of specific growth rate at any one time in relation to the substrate concentration at any one time. Because mu max is a constant and Ks is also a constant. This is derived from Mohtar equation. It gives you another story. Because that value of Ks is a constant, is a value that tells you whether you have chosen the substrate well or not. If the value of Ks is small, then the affinity is big. If the value of Ks is large, then the affinity of substrate to the microbe is small. Therefore, it is a parameter that you can use as the basis to choose the microbe substrate, whether you want to choose glycerol as a substrate or reducing sugar. In terms of that, you use glucose or fructose or sucrose. Yeah, all those assimilable monosaccharides. It gives you this ability to quantitatively make decisions in industry or in the lab. Why you choose certain substrate for a particular microbe? Yeah, this is the value. And you can calculate that. So that's the importance of a monod equation, giving you the value of Ks. Now, thank you. Okay, that gives you the value of mu to be 1 over x, which is the specific growth rate, which measures how the microbes grow in this stubborn places, mostly in this third phase. This is the phase that is important because it is represented by this straight line equation. Here, PXDT equals 0 or near 0. Here it's about picking up. Yeah? And here is maximum. That means mu is maximum here. Now, if you see a growth pattern in industry or in the lab, when students develop this, and you see this type of curve, what does it mean? Low productivity, number one. Number two, you may have problem of inoculum. Inoculum volume may be not enough, or inoculum is not enough, or the freshness or the mobility not good enough. Or your temperature has got big problems, not being able to be sustained in terms of the stability of the temperature. Sometimes 30, sometimes 35, sometimes go to 40, and this, right? So the microbe gets sick, you know, sometimes. Is it snow, and then no snow, snow. You have big problem. Yeah? So, you see, what I'm telling you here is a graphical representation that tells you a story. And it is the story about what's in the fermentation. Yes, Assalamualaikum, how are you? You are late.
I know what
okay.
I'm course.
Don't worry, we know that. I thought you were caught in the snowstorm. Sorry? Correct. It can be also in the presence of that the inhibitors are getting too much concentrated. Imagine this. This is a fermentation vessel. There's only one door, and that door is closed. And we have to stay here for 1 month. What's what's going to happen? How many inhibitory products will be in the room? In terms of gas, in terms of solids, in terms of liquid. We will not be able to survive. That is why you must not think like a microbe. You must feel like a microbe. The microbes are very, very beautiful microbes, beautiful creatures. And they don't like many things, but they like several things. Yeah? For example, they don't like to grow in suspension. And you are telling them to grow in a CSTR, they don't like it. But because of economic consideration, man wants to produce so much so fast. You created CSTR from chemical engineering, and you thought it would be good for the microbes. That's what you would think, but the microbe doesn't think so. Or that they feel like so. That's why you have big problem in industry with regards to wall growth. Microbes like to grow on solid support. So they will start clinging onto the walls, you know? And here you are in a greater than the impeller. Boom, boom, boom. Yeah? So you have microbial film growth. Yeah, and because your fermenter walls are basically in industry using stainless steel with low quality, and you have lots of imperfect surfaces, then you have the point where microbes say grow, and microbes will grow on the wall like this. That is the fermenter wall. Yeah.
And they grow on the impeller.
They can grow on the impeller, yes, but they won't prefer the impeller because it's shearing too much. Oh, it's a support tool. They want to grow, but they have better area to grow, like the wall. Yes. Sorry?
Preferential
growth pattern. And the microbial head, that is your impeller. Or you may have two impellers because of your height of fermentativity too high. So
the preference for the depth.
The preference for the depth is further up because it doesn't like high pressure. It likes 1 atmosphere pressure. And also it will grow. You see, in the fermenter you will see temperature curve. You will have foam curve. You have pH curve. So many probes. And you have dead space there, and the microbe will grow there on the shaft, on the probes and things like that. So you've got to weigh all this in trying to understand the effectiveness of your fermentation system, which is measured by P. And effectiveness of your cellular metabolism, which is measured by 1. Yeah? E. Okay. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. These are important criteria. It must be there, and it will help you to discuss what happens to your fermentation system. Yeah? Now, I've mentioned about KS, which helps you to choose which particular substrate to use. Okay? Now, you know mu, yeah? And then there is another one. Mu is coming from here. And there's another one. This is measuring the rate of utilization of the substrate to be equal to a constant Q and the amount of biomass available in the system. Yeah? So this is referred to as metabolic quotient or the specific substrate utilization. Here is specific growth rate, and there is a connection between the two because the microbes can only grow based on the utilization of the substrate. That is why in this curve, when the microbes are in stationary phase, there is not much movement in the substrate concentration that you put at the beginning. When it starts to grow on an exponential phase, then it starts to utilize the microbes. Yeah? It starts to utilize the substrate until the point where the microbes will reach a stationary phase where there will be no more growth in terms of time. Therefore, the XDT here is about zero, just like here. Yeah? That's when you know you have reached the stationary phase. It has reached stationary phase because it has come up to a level where the condition in the microbe in the fermentation system with regards to energy supply that comes from the medium that is defined by the microbe and the macronutrients, inhibitory products are increasing in concentration, it has to come to a level where it goes to stationary phase. That is where the microbes start to produce secondary metabolites. Example, Antibiotics.
Biofuels.
Acetic acid, yeah, okay. Could be in the primary. Acetic acid is the primary metabolite, not the secondary metabolite. Biofuels will be produced here. Yeah, this is acidogenesis, producing the acid first. This is the solventogenesis, producing the biofuel. Yeah, and you, sorry?
In the stationary
phase to produce the biofuel. So you will get lots of bioethanol here, bioethanol, here. And there will be some hydrogen coming out. And hydrogen here is biohydrogen, and make no mistake, it is not an end product. It is a product by itself. And therefore, when you have that idea that biohydrogen is a product by itself, then you can develop fermentation setup based on these conditions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, to direct the metabolism of the microbes to produce biohydrogen. So you can choose bioacetone, bioethanol, bioethanol, and biohydrogen. And all can be a potential biofuel. The best biofuel among this solvent will be bioethanol.
Yeah.
Bioethanol, because of the characteristic of bioethanol in relation to more energy, and it can replace petroleum in the car without changing the car engine. And in the gas phase, you get biohydrogen, clean. You burn hydrogen, you get water. So it's sustainable, it's environment friendly, it doesn't contribute to the carbon footprint. Because it's only you can make selectively the fermentation conditions for the microbes.
Only one.
No. You produce in terms of the four, which one most
it's a balance.
Yes, it's a balance. Yeah? So you have A, B, acetone, butanol, ethanol. What is the balance? What is the percentage here? X percent, Y percent, Z percent, then A percent. And then this percentage must be equal to 100.
So that's what you want to do?
That's right. That is why in the beginning of the fermentation process, you must decide what would be your product. Yeah? Is your product gas? Then the whole system will have to be configured to produce the gas. Whether it's biohydrogen or biogas or methane. So you've got to know that part of the science. It's not microbiology that part. Huh? If you want solvent, then it has to be in the stationary phase. If you want ethanoic acid, it has to be in the expiration phase, because it is part of the growth. Huh? Part of the growth. So it grows. Sorry?
The
acidogenesis. The production or the synthesis of acids. Butyric acid is the onset of butanol. Acetic acid is for the acid of anything. This will be a little bit deeper in the understanding of it. Yes.
What are the economics of production? More economic to produce just bioethanol,
Then you can just choose a fermentation configuration using just one bioreactor and do some optimization work based on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to get to the maximum biobutanol concentration. And please remember that there is a limit for everything. There is a limit.
What is the normal industrial practice?
Normal industrial practice is to cut down cost, cut down capital expenditure, use one bioreactor, and improve on the fermentation conditions to navigate the metabolism to produce what you want. If, for example, you want to produce ethanol, what microbes do you use? You can use Saccharomyces cerevisiae. Don't use any other because it is popular, it is the best in the industry so far. But if you want to do some research and you know that the use of Saccharomyces cerevisiae requires an anaerobic fermentation. And anaerobic fermentation is slow compared to aerobic fermentation. Then you can search for microbes that can produce aerobically. Yes. That was what we have done for our work in the production of bioethanol. Okay. You have two choices. One, to go into the cell and start changing the sequence. That is genetic engineering. One technique. Another technique is my technique. I don't touch the microbes. I look into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's right. This is my work so far. But I'm not negating the use of mutants. If the mutants are produced via cellular base metagenesis, that means you heat the cell with the UV and the whole cell becomes mutant and you choose which particular one, to me it's okay. But if you go into the cell as class you open and start changing the genetic sequence and make the cell into something that the cell does not know before, then to me it is something that needs a lot of discussion. Because you need to have special medium for it. Okay, you need to have special medium for it, special conditions for it. And you get the cost of producing genetically modified microbes is quite high, and the cost of maintaining it is quite high. So industry will have to weigh between putting money first or putting money later. But because of this element of IPR, intellectual property rights, patenting, companies like to go in the direction of recombinant DNA technology because that is the only time or that is the only position that it can patent the particular microbes because it is theirs. You cannot patent native microbes according to the Catalina protocol. So industries usually like to go that way. But for me, I like to go this way. You're going somewhere? Your lectures? Okay. Okay. So, you have mu, then you have q. You need to connect those two. The connection is this is the connection. The U connects sorry, the other way around. Okay. You know specific growth rate, you know the yield, therefore you can calculate the metabolic quotient. That is
what's the unit?
The unit here, this is this unit is per hour, mu is per hour, yeah, because mu is from here. This is milligram per mil, this is milligram per mil, this is hour, so it's per hour, mu is per hour. Why is no unit? Yeah, no unit. Therefore, Q is per hour. Yeah? This is how you establish the dimension. Yes. It comes from mechanism and kinetics first order. So much now she studies the reaction kinetics reactions. Now, there is another parameter of growth that is quite important, which is doubling time. Doubling time equals log e log 2, this is basically what I mean. It will give you the time when the microbes have doubled. You can do this according to this equation. You can derive this equation.
Why is it so important for the rate of doubling?
Okay. Who wants to answer this? Try. Why is it so important to know doubling time?
Can do that fast.
So that we can calculate this path?
Yeah.
Okay, that's one. Give another one. Most important.
Energy input.
Yeah.
Energy input, okay, not correct.
Yeah, as the matter doubles, we have more heat because they will produce as the motor plant.
Yes.
And then they will produce, they will give up more end products. I will need them to go.
Okay. But in industry, why do you want to know the time?
Because
you will know the time when, at what state, at what the brain, at what state it is to produce that particular product, and you will know the harvesting time.
I thought it's the initiation time, the start time, at the production time. For my
understanding,
the time that it starts.
Doubling time is the time that the microbial biomass doubles itself.
Yeah, but the significance of the process.
Yes, significance of the process is in allowing you to know the time for harvesting. Whether you are going to harvest two doubling time, or one doubling time, or three doubling time, or four doubling, the generation time. One doubling time is one generation. Two doubling time, two generations. So which time will give you the best concentration of the products for the microbe? Then you can develop the definition of the processes better by giving a doubling time. Because doubling time, if you notice, is indirectly proportional to specific growth rate. Yeah? So it's like the balancing act of the growth rate. That is why in a system, like best system, which is a closed system, there is always the positive force and the negative force. It has to come to an end, whatever it is. So, in the third lecture, I will discuss about how to overcome this constraint in the batch process to improve the productivity, to push forward the ability of the system to produce more product. That will be the fed batch or repeated batch or continuous repeated batch or continuous process or continuous with recycled batch. These are modifications of batch process to improve productivity and to improve yield. That is what industry is interested in. Those two, yield and productivity. Whatever you do, they want to measure in terms of that. And you will too want to measure in terms of that in your experiment. Okay?
For the system, when will the system be at the end? When will it be optimized?
Okay. Professor mentioned the word equilibrium. In batch process, the system is always in transient state. Because at any one time,
constantly changing.
The biomass concentration is constantly changing. The
only at equilibrium when everything is done.
It is at equilibrium when the microbes decided to go into death phase,
yeah,
or creation phase, when it's all done and it's equilibrated. Right. At the point of that equilibrium, if you see your substrate is like this, that means you have some problem. Compared to if your S is like this. This is better than this. Why? Yeah.
Oh, so
she's getting excited.
It's my first time as well.
Why is first profile of the substrate compared to second profile is better? Because it's fully consumed. Compared to this, at this particular time. Yeah. At that dt, time dt, this is already zero, this is still have residual. That means your Ks value has not been put into action. That means you have chosen the wrong substrate. Or you have chosen the right substrate, but 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is not being put into your radar to check. So you have problems. That is why this typical growth curve is so important in industry. Without that curve, I will not go forward. Yeah? Yes, yes.
Why do you have a high concentration of substrate in the system more than the microbes?
Why we have?
If we have, to look at that several aspects where it will not be consumed completely, and that will not be good. And what problem do we create?
It is in the nature of the batch process that everything at any one time is in a transient state. It will reach its own position of equilibrium when everything has more or less equilibrated between itself. The concentration of inhibitors going up, concentration of substrate going down, concentration of microbe going up, viscosity going up, that will reduce your aerobicity. So this interacting multivariate factors will make the batch process come to a particular natural stop. Yeah, it's like when we die, the light goes off. Now, that is if you allow the batch process to go its course. But in industry, you don't do that. You look at the doubling time and you specify the doubling time to define your harvesting time. If the doubling time is 4 hours, you cannot harvest in 3 hours. There is no way. Yeah? If you don't know the doubling time, when are you going to harvest? So it is important to know the doubling time to be 4 hours, for example. Then you say, I want to harvest 2 doubling times. So you harvest 8 hours. So the plant manager will be in a position of knowledge in terms of SOP, standard operating procedure. And if anything goes wrong, you double check. Did you harvest at 2 doubling times? No, I harvest at 1.5 doubling times. That's why you can have enough concentration in this, because the profile will give you that. So most important for me is for my students to look at the plant. You can imagine the growth curve. And if you get the growth curve from the plant manager, then the story is very, very full and very, very interesting. Yeah? And if this situation crops up, then you can immediately tell the company, please, employ me as consultant, I will reduce it down. And I will prove to you quantitatively that my work will give you the best productivity. Because I'm going to cut down the time, I'm going to save on the substrate utilization. Yeah? I'm going to increase in terms of the time to reach to the harvesting time. I can develop SOP for the production processes, and they will like it. Okay? So I have come up to this point now where I need to ask questions from the floor. Okay? We've gone through 1 hour 15 minutes. It's a good time to take 5 minute rest. Whilst doing that, you can write down your question and suggest possible answers, then I will comment on the question and on the answer.
I've asked all the questions.
And for Jackson and Madam, you have come.
Come on in.
You come, okay. You have done.
Don't run away.
Jackson will come, I know. You can share with us what you have understood from the first lecture. And from the first lecture, I extend into specific fermentation process. Batch, looking into the kinetic parameters to help you manage the fermentation process in a structured and ordered way, was giving you 5 must criteria that will help you in your lab and in your industrial work. Inshallah, if you follow this, which I have done myself in my consultancy work, they will employ you nicely and pay you good money. Inshallah. And most important, if there is a problem with the fermentation setup, you know how to troubleshoot.
This is easy.
Of course, it's easy because I make it easy. Please. Yeah? And I want my students to feel very knowledgeable about it. It meaning fermentation technology, because it is about a process involving microbes in a controlled environment and in microstructure. I think that environment allows you to be very innovative and really creative. Yeah? And the innovativeness and creativeness goes into the definition of your materials of construction for the fermenter, what did I say in the first lecture? That's most, and how you measure it. Yeah? I cannot overstress more to all my students that you must measure yield and you must measure productivity. And in industry situation, please come up with the growth curve. It is very, very important. It has so much story about it. Yeah? Sorry?
To calculate.
Yeah. You can calculate it. So it is a quantitative approach to the understanding of fermentation process. And it allows you to do some forecasting because you have a mathematical model. Yeah? The mathematical model that defines the exponential phase is this. The mathematical model that defines the interrelatedness of mu, which is the specific growth rate, with the substrate. Sorry. When you talk about specific growth rate, which is basically in our definition, is equal to the growth rate per concentration of microbes. You know it's related to the substrate concentration like that. So how do you increase your substrate concentration? Sorry, how do you increase your mu? You increase your mu by increasing your substrate concentration and by decreasing your Ks. How do you increase your specific substrate utilization? You increase your mu, and then you decrease your efficiency, your YXS. Yeah? So, in a closed system like that, called fermentation, or whatever closed system, there will always be positive forces and negative forces. And you've got to balance between these two. And for what I mentioned, when is it that it is in equilibrium? My answer is when it gets run its own course, or you decided to harvest. That point of harvesting, it is the point of equilibrium where you want your bioengineering to be maximum. So you draw a profile of bioengineering concentration, ethanol concentration, existing concentration, and you decide to harvest at that time. And that time is also characterized by one particular doubling time. Yeah? So, that is the whole story for addressing fermentation systems for specific troubleshooting instances. Here, I want to look at this condition, stable physical chemical condition. as I mentioned, you have to have a stable temperature for the culture. How do you do that? You have this instrumentation. I will discuss instrumentation in the next lecture. What do you do to control the temperature? What do you do to control the pH? If you want to control the pH, what do you do to control most important pH and temperature and RPM? And there is also foam. You have a foam probe and you put in some kind of oil to reduce the foam. It's anti surface active agent. So, there are many work with regards to this, because the question is whether you want to control pH during fermentation or you don't control pH. My reading on the matter, literature review, says that or suggests that you allow the pH not to be controlled in the batch process. It gives you better effectiveness for the cell to produce what they want to produce. Yeah? Because it is not a forced situation. If you control the pH, you are forcing the microbe to be in an environment that it is not natural for the microbe in a batch transient process. Yeah? Remember, microbes are very specific organisms that react in a very specific way within a multi varied component, most of which you do not know. It seems that generally for a batch process you don't control the pH. Just let it grow. The natural profile for the pH is to go down. And that is because of the production of primary acids that is involved in the growth. The growth associated products are acids that are produced. And that gives you the indicator for fermentation process to be going the right way. Yeah. Okay, any more questions? Yes, Prof. That is the seventh question you asked. Okay.
I can't follow it.
Well, I can't
hear. Stupid question.
No, it's
not. Are the secondary metabolites always in the pH? It does not depend on the microbe that
the It depends on the microbe, yes.
It depends on
the microbe. Of course.
So it's not necessarily always A, B, E, H.
It will always be A, B, E, H, but in different concentration.
So if you start with A, you are starting with it and you screen a microbe.
Okay.
It makes sense then to talk about the selectivity of the process rather than the E.
Agree. What do you mean by selectivity of the process?
That means when you first screen the microbe.
Okay.
And the process is to screen for selectivity.
Of the microbe.
Of the microbe.
Correct.
The secondary metabolite.
Correct.
There can be you will optimize
Correct. The process. Correct. The first microbe that we worked with to produce biomedicinal is a Japanese microbe. Prostridium acetylenterical M14. Yeah? But in my group, I am the boss. I said I want my own microbe. I don't like
isolate yours.
Yes. What we did say is correct. So I isolated. We isolated our own microbe, and we have our own locally isolated microbe, and it is a super producer of biomethanol because it came from a very specialized soil.
I think if I ask another question, I'll be thrown out.
That is correct. This goes back to the specificity of microbial action to its environment. That is why the most important part of fermentation process is the microbes. I have my own microbe, I've given a paper to that we have isolated a clostridium that are usually anaerobic, but ours is oxygen tolerant. Not if it's going to be oxygen tolerant, then we can be operated in aerobic fermentation. It can produce a lot more, and we have published lots of papers using that microbe. That microbes are isolated from soil that are free from chemicals. We isolated that microbe from rice field that has not used chemicals at all in the growing of the rice. So they produce organic plants. They use biofertilizers. They don't use chemicals at all, or pest control, or nutrients, NPK, no. So after the fourth season, we went to take some samples, and we were looking for clostridium. And we got this clostridium, and it happened to be a super producer for biofuels now. We know that because we did some experiment, we published, and it was published. Yeah? So, professor is correct, we need to get our own microbe. If you don't, no problem. You can buy from cultivar collections. Yeah? Because it demands you to go through various microbiological techniques, and these are basic microbiology, really, to get to the isolation of your own microbes. And you have to test it, and you have to make sure it is the microbe. Now, if you just test biochemically, they won't agree. They want you to use molecular techniques to further identify that it is the microbe. But my experience, in the end, I asked the molecular biologist in my team, what would be the end most convinced data that it is the microbe? It is not the molecular data. It is the SPM data. Because you can see, it's like that. So, the field of fermentation technology is, to me, very exciting because it allows you to look into the world, the beautiful world of the microbe, its specificity in producing various types of products and services for men, and this is in the literature of biotechnology. And it gives you strong independence. I was in the database, and I was there just to follow Professor on the project. I was just carrying her bag, you see. When I went into the room, I was talking to the CEO of Almos, and I mentioned about the use of microbes in producing fuel and in producing food, especially rice. Independent of chemical input, important. And he was very excited about it. We end up having to discuss my project more than Professor John's project. Okay, any questions?
Let me ask you that, please.
Okay.
Why the exponential phase of the graph is more important than the death phase?
Why the exponential phase is more important than
the death phase?
The death phase. Uh-huh. Very interesting question. Nobody likes to talk about death in science. And usually, they don't want to start in the death phase. That is why the death phase in literature, they don't call it the death phase. They call it cryptic growth. Yeah? Number two, usually products in fermentation industries comes from the exponential phase and the stationary phase. So that phase really is a phase that geologists like to discuss. That has very little implication to industrial advancement for the time being.
I close to
agenda. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I have also. Okay.
That is also to reach. Right. We can publish that. We are publishing next.
The agenda is not closed.
Yeah.
The agenda is not
closed. Yeah. I think you can get the Nobel Prize.
Yeah.
That would be a good thing.
But they leave the generation. They leave the generation.
Yeah.
Actually, I have correctly forgot. I did not say anything about microbe when I talk about the selective.
Yes.
I only look at it from the context point of view.
Okay.
And then you make the assumption that the most important part
is the microbe. Okay, I understand why Prof has got that approach in mind, because she's studying catalysis. Yeah? Catalysis is like what we study here, but here we are studying biocatalysis, enzymes.
And quite different assumptions also.
Quite different.
That now I understand after explaining the double time.
Yes.
Because in chemical kinetics,
yes,
you assume that you are taking, you're only interested at the end of the reaction.
Mm-hmm.
But here you're not taking product at the end of the reaction.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So the growth phase of the organisms is for veg cultures.
Yes.
And in non-homogeneous cultures, you have to find one culturate.
Yes, right.
So for different microorganisms and for production of different end products,
yes,
we mostly search for related connections.
Yes. Okay.
But it depends sometimes.
Correct.
And not only for the productivity, but also viability is important.
Okay.
So later the explanation in the stationary phase, lower the viability.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And additionally, different end products other than the input, but the end products are mainly the biological residues.
Okay.
Mainly with this.
They get
a lot. And
yes.
So we can optimize our system by several different experiments to see which phase is the best.
Correct.
Or which condition and which organism.
Agreed.
But what did you see in your experience?
My experience will be along the same approaches as what Dr. Bidem has mentioned. We need to go through the definition of the fermentation processes and to come up with the growth curve and the substrate degradation curve and the product profile. There will be a product profile that comes out like that.
Sure.
Yeah? If it is non-growth related. If it's growth related, it will be like this. So, it's important, you are right, we have to look at three profiles. Biomass profile, substrate profile, product profile. Yeah? And you tie up with your yield data and your productivity data based on the mode of the extract operation batch. Then you have a very nice understanding. But they didn't mention another mode of great opportunities. Continue. It's another technique. Batch process is here. Continuous is here. It's on the other side.
numbers of fish.
That's right. This is the schematic representation of a continuous process. It has a pump to allow volumetric flow rate of fresh medium going into the system, and another pump, if you don't have money to buy another pump, you use a wheel, so that F in equals F out. Why? Because you want to ensure that your V is constant. If your feed is not constant, then you are violating the definition of the continuous process. Because all mathematical assessment of continuous process assumes V to be constant. And steady state condition can only be achieved if and only if feed is constant. And to do that, you must have Turkish made peristaltic pump and another Turkish made. It's not even Germany.
People German.
People German, okay, that's good.
Best one.
Not the Chinese one, sorry.
Okay. Why do you want
Okay.
It's not possible to have one curve, right? One syllable process and call it something like overall transformation.
The answer is if the
difficult to achieve, or if you do a mathematical model, it's not so accurate, or what?
And the answer is this. If your objective is to produce biomass, and only biomass, then in the one curve, the biomass curve. But if your objective is to produce product, then you need to know two curves, two profiles, the biomass profile and the product profile. Because the product can only come from the biomass. And if you know those two profiles, you can even develop multi-phase fermentation setup. First phase conditions optimum for growth only. Then you transfer into another phase using same fermenter conditions that are amenable for maximum product formation. If you have lots of money, you buy two fermenters. First fermenter for biomass production, second fermenter for product formation. If you're not doing research, you don't have to measure the S substrate profile, because you don't need to measure G or anything. In order to measure G, you have to have the substrate profile. But you can measure without the G and without the S substrate curve the productivity, because productivity is amount of product per volume of fermentation per time. So it is independent of your substrate. But to do research, yeah, it's better to measure all three so that you can drive more discussion, and the director of your paper will like it better. Now, this is, like Dr. Vidam has indicated, a very interesting mode of bioreactor operation. We know why. Because at a steady state condition, the specific growth rate equals to the dilution rate, and it is equal to the volumetric flow rate per unit volume of your culture volume. What does this mean? It means that if It means that mu specific growth rate is directly proportional to your volumetric flow rate, which is controlled by your pump. Now you have a beautiful system called continuous fermentation that enables you to control what is inside the cell with what is outside the cell. MashaAllah, this is beautiful.
Yes, beware of washouts.
Beware of washouts, of course. And then, in the batch process, we have to be beware of doubling time so that we know when to harvest. In the continuous process, we have to be beware of washouts.
Oh, okay.
So we don't supply enough time to go to the
microorganism.
That's
right. Huh? Does it
make it into the wall?
I mentioned in the earlier part that the microbes by nature does not like to grow in suspension.
Yeah, this is not
the problem. Yeah, the idea there was here. We can use bacteria to produce the biomass. So anything that requires biomass production is good to be here. This particular unit process is used in wastewater treatment a lot. Because this will represent their big aeration pond. Before that will be the primary clarifier, after that will be the secondary clarifier. And this will represent your big aeration pond. If you do this work well, your size of aeration pond will be very much reduced and you will reduce the capital for the company and you will do the job. Now, it is interesting here to note that, as I mentioned, the intrinsic capability of the cell can now be controlled by the extrinsic parameters of the system. And you can control it. Meaning to say, you can say, please, microbe, you can work at 0.3 per hour. Okay, no. Next week you work at 0.5 per hour. You see, by just changing this volumetric flow rate. And if you look at another profile of continuous process. This is the position where the turbid emission was out. You will see that no matter how you increase your F, as long as your V is constant, your steady state biomass concentration is constant. Yeah?
And this is the indication of steady state.
This is the indication of steady state.
Also not only this, but also the other parameters.
Yes.
And this is why Professor Thomas Mann. The question, not only one or two profiles, and we actually have to follow maybe at least five parameters.
Yes.
Let's say pH. In some processes, pH drops suddenly from 7.5 to 10.5 to 6.2 in pH at the end of the exponential growth phase. So
yeah.
If you don't
the harvest,
your microorganism,
they will
die.
Yes, that will be in reference specific to the batch process.
Mm-hmm. And also
the same consideration, also important for the
continuous
process. And you can have this curve to help you, you can have another curve to help you. Productivity curve. As you increase your D, dilution factor, which is F upon V, your R, which is productivity, increases. at a very profitable rate until the time you come to critical dilution rate. After that, you will have, after the critical dilution rate, you will have an exponential reduction because of the fast flowing displacement
and
therefore washout. Therefore, you must know this when you want to operate continuous process. If you don't know this, you have a big problem. Because you don't know where you are. It's like walking in the dark.
You don't concentrate.
That's right. So, these are interesting aspects of how you relate yourself to the microbes. And I mentioned just now, do not think like a microbe, you must feel like a microbe. The microbe has feelings. I used to talk to
myself.
Yes, right. Put yourself in there and you can feel it. Whether you want to.
They are not the experiments we've done, they are experiments.
That's right. They are teaching us something. All these data are signs of how they behave to you. They're talking to you, and I want to look into that, yes, then you will enjoy it. I remember having to work in my lab when I was in PhD. It was very cold, like this too. And I had nobody else to talk to, so I talked to the microbe, please grow. I want to go home with my fish. I had to take samples every 4 hours. At the 4 o'clock to help me to wake up and take samples, because we had no automatic sampler, no? But I think Fatih will have that. Okay? So these are batch and continuous. Now, I want to ask you this question. You want to produce bioethanol. Yeah? It has wide application. It has high volume requirements. Which particular mode of bioengineering operation would you prefer? Any guess? Why? Okay. Very good. Give another reason. I want to take her as my
student.
Oh, come on. Very good. Give me another reason. Why you just continue? There is no information phase in
continuous.
Okay, I will answer that question. Because the market requires large volume. Yes, make sure it's the German pump.
Yep.
Not the Malaysian pump,
yep.
Or a Chinese pump. Braun pump. You know, Braun pump. You know, what's the matter of pump?
Yeah. Right.
I think what's the matter of pump. Yeah. Very good answer, but lacking the economic input of the production of bioethanol. As fermentation technologies, you must think from the feeling of the microbes to the feeling of man. And you have to balance. It's very important. Microbes are important, but they are there to serve man. But man must know the limits. Yeah? You must not abuse the microbe. You must not abuse the microbe. There is limit everything. If you go beyond the limit, you must know that you are going into uncharted territories. Okay, another process is the fat batch process.
What kind of reactor operation would take you?
Have you read anything about the fat batch process? For every choice, there is a reason. For every move, there is a reason. Yeah? I mentioned to you, why did you choose that particular substrate? The answer is, why did you choose this particular substrate for the microbe? The answer is,
Not microbe.
This is microbiology. Pure microbiology. Yes. KS is related to the affinity of the substrate to the microbe. If your KS is small, you will get this profile. If your KS is bigger than the small ones, you will get this profile. If you get it,
affinity of the
microbe to the substrate.
You are saying that is a natural affinity.
This is why when you change the sequence of the gene, you pass off on the genome, you change the sequence of the genes, you are changing the intrinsic value and intrinsic property and intrinsic behavior and intrinsic feeling of that microbe. And that makes it very hard. Because we have to doubt the microbe. But for a good reason, no problem. There is always a limit to the limit.
But is there a repository, like a
Microbiologists that are being exposed to fermentation therapy courses. But if they are not, then they don't know. They don't teach this in basic microbiology course, no. They don't teach this. This is in fermentation technology course.
Can I teach those in the
bioengineering? Yes. To explain biodecomposition,
just to design it.
Okay, that's fine. So, coming back to fat batch, why do industry or why do we want to employ fat batch? You must ask this question always. Why do I choose batch? Why do I choose fat batch? Why do I want, what is the rationale? Therefore, it comes to the third part of the seminar which I will give you, which is
Thank you.
Yeah, it is about this part. Reason for doing the project. Really, it is so important this part. That is why the Lemon Island Atenor is working very hard to establish the literature survey, the literature review. What have people done? What have other researchers reported? What is known? What is not known about the project? And the project, as I told you in the first lecture, is embodied in the title. Yeah? So if you give me a title of the project, then we will be able to look into the thinking or the development of the direction of the project and the rationale. The rationale for the project. Why do you want to do this project? Then you will go forward into developing your objective, which I have mentioned to you. This is the thinking process. Yeah? If you remember, why you want to achieve this objective? Why not that objective? If you say you want to achieve objective 1, 2, 3, and then we evaluate and say, no, you cannot achieve this objective. There's no way. Then you will say, oh, we will be changing objectives. When we change objectives, we may be changing the reason for doing the project. And you may be changing the title. This is why at the end of a PhD or a master's program, the title is changed. You change the title all the time. But the most important part of the work here is the synchronization of the title with the reason for doing the project that enables you to list down relevant objectives. And then you can do your materials and methods and so on. The whole part of this will develop, will define your master's of PhD. This is implementation part. This materials and methods is the result in the discussion, is conclusion. Note that I separate result and discussion. I did not say results and discussion as one chapter. No, I say results, one chapter. Discussion in another chapter, because most students will have big problem in discussion. Yeah? Big problem. Until now, after I have gone through 20 of our master's and PhD students, I still find this problem with any student. You're coming?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, this thing.
For two hours of interactive sessions, and I really hope that Jackson and the lady and the man from the gym will be able to come up with important operationable project paper. And I see you are coming to the president.
We are preparing a plastic project, not for.
Of course.
As a friendship.
Oh, okay.